And we are in chapter seven.
No.
Chapter one. So if you missed last class?
Yeah.
We have a huge gap in our videotaping.
It's an 18-minute gap. It's word game. Okay, actually, we're in verse four. Because I refuse to share it for verse three, two, or one. So that we may finish this by doing this discussion.
Which one?
Verse four.
Verse four.
In him was life, and the life was the light of men. Okay. You know, there are certain things that the Bible says is God is. God, not Jesus is, but God is. Okay? There's not a whole lot of things that says God is. Is it? There's not. There's a lot that says Jesus is. Not a lot of things that says God is. One of them is that says God is light. And it seems to me like when Scripture says God is life, I know it says God is love. If it does say life, then God is all the old words. My significance is this is not Greek, but one. But here we have life and light, and we have the order given. The order given. In him was life, and the life was the light. The life was the light. The life is the light. All right. Now, people sometimes wonder why you have to preach the gospel, or why there has to be, we've always said around here, we have this statement that says, it takes a life to get a life. It takes a life to get a life. Somebody has to lay down their life before life can come forth in anybody else. Taking that a little bit different way, I believe that it takes a life before somebody can even see the light. Before they can really see the light. And here's why. Here's why I would say that. The light is the light. The life is the light. We keep seeing them as separate, but the life is the light. And to have to see the life as it really is, you have to have light. Now, we were kind of discussing this on Sunday, but I want to just not go deep into it, but I want to kind of bring this out. Light. Light does not make anything. Light reveals what is. Those are the, maybe you don't understand my terminology when I say what is. But if we just understand it in the natural, the example I gave Sunday night, is that if you walk into an unfamiliar room that has lots of furniture, maybe things and whatever, you will trip and stumble and have to feel your way and everything else. But if you turn on the light doesn't set the room in order. The light reveals the order to you. The light makes what already was before you had light. Before you had light, the light simply reveals that. Okay. So life is first, and then light. Life is first. When we say what is, and I use this terminology a lot, what is, to know what is art. The reason why a lot of people don't understand me when I use this terminology, it reveals what is because they don't know what it is. They go, well, what are you talking about? I'm talking about what is true in the beginning, what is true where there was just the Word and God who is Father. I'm talking about revealing what was and is and is to come. I'm talking about knowing the reality of God apart from sense realm information, because it's not of this realm. See, I don't even, it's been so long, I don't even know what somebody might think I'm saying. All I know is what is. It's not because I made it that way. The light that came to me simply revealed what is. It didn't make it, it always had been. The light revealed the life, and it wasn't that Randy had to put something in order, or that Randy had to work it, or that Randy had to, do anything. The light simply revealed that it was all there, settled in Christ. Now, those are words. They're just words. We hear words a lot. But for a person to truly have light on this relieves so much burden, it's unbelievable. Because it's no longer what you have to bring about, because it already was and is. It's not what you have to do, because the works were finished from before the foundation of the world. It's not the work that you have to accomplish in the future, because you have entered into the rest. His rest. It says His rest, not yours. And so we read in the scriptures, and when we read in the scriptures, usually the light of the law shines. And we see, and the law is like the Pharisees. They point their finger at you and say, you're not measuring up, or you're not doing good enough, or you're not in the Word enough, or you're not this or that. It condemns. The law condemns. But it shows you where you're wrong in this realm, in the sense realm. It shows you your daily failures. But that has absolutely nothing to do with this life. To reveal your shortcomings still doesn't reveal the life. I know a lot of people that they say, oh, brother, preach it hard, beat the bull out of me, because they feel better when they've been beat up. They don't know any more than what they knew, but they feel better because they got all whooped up on them. They don't know the life. They just know they have the life of the law that has told them, you have failed. And if they can respond, they feel pretty good about it. Okay, at least I break. I heard people say, at least I break. Well, good. But you're going to go back to doing the exact same thing you did until you see the life. You know what I mean? And I'm not putting down breaking or whatever, but I'm just saying that the truth is, until this light has come, we all want light on the subject. You know, Lord, give me light on my present circumstances. Lord, give me light in reference to direction for my life. Lord, give me light on the scriptures. But the light is the life, and the light reveals what is the life as it is, as God sees it. It is a full acceptance on God's part of us, because we're in Christ. But people who don't measure up but are always trying to earn, number one, they don't mind the law that much, because it keeps them going. And it keeps them alive in this earning thing. The worst news in the world for somebody that wants to earn their way is that it's also I mean, that's the worst thing in the world. But for somebody who has really tried to earn and failed, and has tried to live up to standards and failed, and sincerely tried and meant it, when they find that there's a door apart from the law. And it is through the grace of Jesus Christ, they grab it, and they cannot do without it. They cannot do without it. This isn't a, well, I just believe. It's not that at all. I believe the grace of God. No, there's something in them that is constantly aware of the great grace of God. Who was I talking to? Somebody today. Mr. Mike Wallace and I were talking, and I said, I was talking about the precious blood. And Jesus' blood is only blood, which doesn't really mean a lot. I remember there was a place that I got to know. I went, blood of Jesus. We're always talking about the blood of Jesus, and I respect it, and I believe, but I ain't got a clue about the blood of Jesus. I've been a Christian for 10 years or something. I don't care what it was. But it was like, the blood of Jesus. Big deal. I mean, I really didn't mean that disrespectfully. I'm just saying, kind of talking back to me. Big deal. It don't mean that much to you. And of course, around the Lord in that sense, I know there's something there to you, so I respect it. But it don't seem to have anything. But as I begin to understand the blood and the grace of God, I begin to realize how precious it was. Because if it wasn't for the blood of Jesus, I would have to stand before God on my own merits. And I don't measure up. I can't. I think it's me and Deb were talking about this. And I said, because she's helped me. We've been married 23 years this year. She knew me 2 years before that when I was in Bible school learning the Lord. She knew me when I was learning the Lord for the first time, seeing the one that I've been preaching all these years. And I said, Deb, I am so weak. I am not strong. I'm so weak. And the proof that I'm just probably the weakest person around is that as I look at people in the church, I look at people in other churches, and there's so much strength. People have so much strength that it's hard for God to break them because they have so much will to go on, or strength to try again, or I don't know, it amazes me. I mean, I am totally in shock that not only there are people like that, but it seems to be most people. Because I went for like 9 months carrying the law, and I just went, I can't do it, I love it, I hate this, and I can't do it, I'm no good, I'm wretched, I've failed, I really, really want to, I want to please you, and I can't do it. And then began to see the cross. And I told Deb, I said, it's not an honorable thing to be that way. It's a pretty sad thing. I said, in the long run, it's a pretty nice deal because you didn't see the Lord saying it. But it's not because of merit. Weakness should not be seen as any sort of merit. In fact, it's pretty pitiful that you can't go much longer than that. You don't have any more stamina than that. You just break down in a heap, fall down, crawl up to the cross, and go, and just start, having to embrace the door of faith because you don't have anything else. But the only way that this light can shine, I believe, is that when we're ready, and that's why we're going to see that very soon after this, there's a man sent from God named John, and he came to bear witness of the light. He didn't even come to share the light. He came to bear witness of the light so that you can see the light, because the light is light, and go from there. But he couldn't even declare himself. He just came and basically said, repent. And that begins to bring you down. Because repentance automatically assumes failure. It begins to work on you. And he's preparing the way of the Lord. Failure. Repent. Shape up. And that is not the way of the Lord. That prepares the way. Does anybody know the difference?
The law validates that the person is looking for righteousness of their own. The law validates their successes, like the rich young ruler. The law validated him what he considered to be a successful life until he came into direct contact with Christ.
Right.
And the life of Christ. And Christ, Jesus, overshadowed the law and said, "The fact that you have to come and follow me," where it was beyond what the rich young ruler could do by following the law. He had to follow Jesus, and he couldn't do that. And in that aspect, that's when he realized that he was no good, whether he wanted to admit it to Jesus or not. He went back and, you know, he left. But for some, the law validates their successes.
Right. Yeah, it does. The other son, you know, there's many examples in the scriptures of people, the Pharisees, thrived on the law. Yeah. And they must be tremendously strong people. I mean, you see, I don't say that in a negative sense. I mean, almost in a certain sense, I admire them. It just says that those that are this weak must be tremendously weak. You just fall under the weight of it that quick. But then, you know, okay, well, you are. And it's worse than everybody else. But it makes you needing something that you can't provide within yourself. And it makes you open for the first time for life to shine and you to see a whole nother realm of hope. And you didn't have any strength. And all of a sudden you jump up and you run. And jump in that other realm and go, "My goodness, this is wonderful." You know, it's wonderful. But there has to be an openness to that. And in most cases, we haven't come to that. Because we're yet strong, we're yet striving. And much of the strength and striving comes from a genuine love for the Lord. That's the thing. It's not because we don't love the Lord, it's because we do love the Lord. But we think that through this method, and if this is the only method you know, to get weak, faint, and quit is the worst thing. And I remember when I got to the point where I was seconds away from getting weak, fainting, and having to totally quit. And I felt so bad because I love the Lord and I didn't want to fail him, but I was a failure. And the example I was thinking of was like holding on to this tiny end of the rope, knowing the old saying, "Tie a knot on the end and hang on," ain't going to work because you can't hang on anymore. But you're slowly slipping off the last thread and you're feeling every ounce of guilt and failure because you know that the Lord is everything. Never want to fail him. Only to find it's like as you slip off that you fall under the shadow of his wing or whatever, and he begins to reveal himself in a whole new way. And you just go, "No, what?" You know, I mean, it is unbelievable the great grace of God, the great love of God, the light that begins to shine at that point. But, you know, only God can bring a person to that point, and only a person can cry out, "Lord, bring me to a place that I don't know about." Most of us, because we want to control and we want to know before we do and all this, never was ready, "Bring me to a place I don't know about." Because we know what that brings up in us. But with the Father, it's okay to pray that because he's okay. He's going to do you right. He's not going to do you wrong. You don't know that yet. And so this is how you learn. Yeah, did you have a comment?
I was just going to say that with the combination of the love of the Lord and the earning mentality, that, I guess more the earning mentality, you said that kept it going. And so that's just, it's actually like feeding and deceiving.
Yes.
It's deceiving that this is the way. And he doesn't realize it, like you're saying here, though, in the Lord, that it's to, the real purpose is to bring it down, to prepare for the way of the Lord. But it's within itself, if the Lord doesn't start showing you, it's deceiving you that this is.
I was thinking of similar, I was thinking about the strength of some people, and I wonder if it's not strength, it's just a good one as much as self-deception.
Well, it's a combination.
You know, because I think for me is that I don't think I'm really that strong of a person, I just think I'm convinced that I am. At times, you see, that I'm really not living, and I'm not. See, so I'm seeing things wrong, and if I really saw my true state, the way it really was, I would realize, no, I'm not strong, but I convinced myself I'm not.
Right. I don't know. I don't know if this was a factor or not, but I had this, of course, back in the 60s, so I had this mentality, man of truth. And so I wasn't going to deceive myself about God and my relationship with Him. I was going to, you know, if I didn't have it, I was going to say, well, bless God, I just don't have it. So I don't know that I really understand that kind of self-deception at that point, but I, from my perspective, but I do understand it from others' perspective, and the best way to do it is just go, you know, if I got it, I got it, and here's the best one, if you got it, it's got you. If you're having to work it, I know one of the things, it was like, and I even drew a chart of this way back, back then, of this guy pushing this car up this hill, pushing this car, and it's rolling back on him, and he's using all of his strength to get it up. And you know that if you let go of this sucker, it's going to roll over you. And that's what I remember it feeling. And so I had to maintain it, lean into it, and keep it. And you know, sometimes I'd get it going a little bit, and then I'd start getting tired because you had to really push to get it going. And then, you know, it would start creeping. And have you ever pushed a car where it's up a hill and your feet start sliding backwards as you're, whoa, you know, you start feeling that, you go, oh, God, I'm losing ground. And it was like, I drew this chart after I began to see this, it was like, all of a sudden, I realized that this is a car, it has gas in it and a motor. It runs itself. You know what I mean? I don't have to get here to do, I'm doing this the wrong way. I got the right thing, I just am not in the right position or something, which is real true of us.
I think I've seen that one person that Charlie Bears in about that. I think it is like an honesty issue that I think we like judge everything kind of, I tend to judge like the way I judge myself is based on what everyone else says about me. I think we all grow up that way, so if we are like putting on the good works and everything, then everyone else is going to think we're okay. And
right.
So then we automatically think we are too, even though inside, you know, something a lot different.
Right. Well, I remember reading too a lot of, you know, what Jesus would say to the Pharisees. It was always the Pharisees that he had the hard time. You know, because the sinners were just sinners, they just needed him, so they'd flock around him. The Pharisees would go to him. And he'd say, you're a whited sepulcher. On the inside is junk, you know, but you look good on the outside. And, you know, there's a, we have the Holy Spirit, we have the life of Christ, we have pastors, we have, but really, nobody else can keep you as right as you can. But when I say you, I'm talking about spirit, soul, and body. I'm talking about the you of your spirit. You in conjunction with the Holy Spirit and the life of Christ, not you the soul, because the you the soul wants the things of the soul. Some of you never really got that from that discipleship thing that I had sometime back, but you're never going to change the soul. Devin, I don't know about this. The soul has certain motivations. Did you know that? Your soul is motivated by certain things. And your spirit has certain motivations. What we do is we see the motivations of the soul and we try to change those motivations. And we spend all of our time trying to make the soul not the soul. When the best thing to do is not to change that motivation, but to change from that motivation to the motivations of the spirit. We want this pure And see, this is where the devil or our mind says, well, you're not really after God. Because if you were after God, you wouldn't have these thoughts or these motivations. You wouldn't do this. Well, that's pretty dumb. The soul is not after God, but I'm after God. My spirit ain't very strong, you know. The spirit is willing, but, you know, it's weak through the flesh.
Yeah, I promise I'll point to that right now, because it's like there are certain things that I react to. Just unsensitive reaction, physically, whatever, just mentally. And especially when today, it would keep happening, and it's really funny, because instead of going, trying to find some sort of strength to get over, I got to this point where I've decided, since I'm trying to say I'm strong, I just need to admit that I'm actually weak enough. Okay. And I confess that to the Lord, but I'm not confessing that, in one sense, that I'll never get through it. I have to admit that I haven't been doing this, but I'm doing this and so forth. And it's just so funny because I'm going to show you, because I do that, and as soon as I do that, something happens, I react the same thing again. Weird. So, Joe's had to go back to realizing that it is a problem. Once you admit it's a problem, then you got to go on to start testing it. You can't get through it. Yeah. Even if you do, if you get it all taken care of, it's not a good job. Because it's trying to accomplish something.
Right. Right. And that's good. By going with your spirit, you'll end up going with the Holy Spirit and the Spirit of Christ, which is conforming. That is what conforming to Christ is. About one. What would you think? You know, we would be going to Jesus. That's conforming. No, that's Jesus. That's not conforming. By going with his nature and the Holy Spirit's direction, that's conforming to us, conforming to Jesus. But the going with the soul is us giving place to our soul and walking in the center. Okay. Well, how do you do? This one. You know, we've moved into some new words now. We've been using the same and the total thought and concept of God, the Word. But the life, because when we think of life, we think in terms of us. So we have to reduce it down, although it's not reduced at all. We have to exchange the total thought and concept of the Father toward His Son, which is the same, is the life that we receive. Okay? And you can receive it and not have life. You can receive it and not really have life. So the goal really is to see it as it is. When we see Him as He is, we should be like Him. To see what is. To see Him as He is. It's all the same stuff, just slightly different words. When we finally see Him as He is, we'll be like Him. Okay, so the goal isn't as He is, because as He is, was, and is to come. The goal is to see Him. The goal isn't life, for life has always been. The goal is light. The life is the light of men. You understand? So you have to see what is. This is the same. This is the total thought concept of God. But you have to have light on that. You have to see that.
Uh-huh. Yeah, Lord told me that you'll never be able, or I'll never be able to see that by looking for myself in Christ. The only way that I'll be able to see that is by looking at Christ.
Right.
And not trying to find myself or where I am in there.
Right. We're not looking for ourselves in Christ, because this is that which was from the beginning before you. We haven't gone very far now. You shouldn't be resting too far away. We've only gone four scriptures now. You shouldn't be off in religion and Christianity and everything else. We have barely left the beginning and got stuff created. you know, so where are you? Let's get back to the beginning. And you were not there in the beginning. But you know what? You really were there. Did you know that? You were there in the beginning. But you were not there. But so we don't look for ourselves in Christ. We see the Christ in whom we are. Now, that's way later. He's called the Christ. We see the life in whom we are. We see the complete thought and concept of God. We see Him who is the same. And we say, I'm in there somewhere, and all that He is, I am, because He said, of God am I in Christ. And I will not leave this reality. Now, as you begin to look away from the sense realm, as it were, and of course, in reality, your spirit begins to look towards this. Your soul still has gravity, and that's a good way of putting it, gravity that is earthward. Pull, it's downward motivation. We talked about that before. It's down motivation. But there is something that can break that motivation. I believe that for a time there is this duality working where the spirit is struggling. It's like a caterpillar in a cocoon. It's struggling to get out of the death bonds of the old. It's struggling to make a break. And it is, as much as it knows how, peering, gazing in this direction, you know, through tapes or books or anything, you know. The spirit is longing in that direction, and from time to time it gets glimpses, but it has not really seen it. Okay, but at the same time, there are these downward motivations as active as the other, and sometimes, depending on the environment we have down here, and of course, there's two different environments. There's the earthly environment, which can be made an environment of the Lord, or may not be, or at times may be, and at times not. It is when you're in the body, and it's not when you're at work or something. You see what I'm saying? But this environment is, make it according to this pattern. This is, there is no total environment without this. This is where it came from. It's total. This is total. This never can be totally. There must be heresies among you that the truth of God might be made manifest. That right there takes it to be a total. He sowed good seed in his field. Then while men slept, an enemy came and sowed a bad field. And then the workers came and said, from whence came these tares? I thought you sowed good seed. I did. An enemy had done this. So there's really down here no such thing as a total environment, but we know the concept of total environment because there is a total environment. The reality as it is in Christ. Now what are we doing? Thy kingdom come, a place of rule and government, meaning you're in charge, not us. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth. Right? Or do we just blow it off and go, well, as long as I'm up here? But ultimately, we want to bring that down. Okay, so this is where the struggle between the two comes, because we hear these things, our spirit bears witness with it, we wrestle. At times, we find ourselves, when we're in the presence of the Lord and in the presence of the Word, we find ourselves very desirous of the Lord, very desirous. It's amazing that, because we go, man, I really am. But then when we find ourselves in the presence of sense realm darkness, when we find ourselves in the presence of other things, anything other than this is sense realm darkness. So it's not necessarily bad friends. Good friends can have the same effect. Now, God friends can form an environment of this. Do you get the point? So, you know, this isn't good and evil. This is life. So there is this struggle, there is this wrestling, there is this great desire at times for the Lord, and at other times, amazing that we walk away from what we know is in us and what we desire so much and don't seem to flow with that and go even to look in shock at ourselves and go, what is wrong with you? And then walk right off. And then, but later, to be confronted not with this because we haven't seen it, but from the presence of this through somebody or through just what God has set up, we'll kind of walk back in the outer edges of that world again and find yourself melting again because, and knowing, this is really what I want. So why did I, you know, and it's just, it's this, it, this is where you get the concept of civil war. Civil war. And let me tell you, there's a lot of, war is never good, but the worst war is civil war. That's a fact. The worst war this country ever fought is the civil war. It's nothing like being together, unified, even against an enemy. There's bloodshed, but there's something glorious about that, but there's something just tragic even when you win about fighting against yourself. And so this horrible, horrible struggle, you know, because there are doubts at times when you're in the presence of this, whether this will ever be known and really win out. And then there are times when you feel so strong and secure that something slight can come along and pull you off, and you go, my God, what is the deal? Greg? You don't get what you're going to say. You
do. Oh, yes, I do. Sorry. Look, gosh, kind of worth going back to what I was saying earlier. It's really cool. There would be areas of my life that are blowing, so to speak, you know, kind of bad thought. And the immediate thing to do is think, okay, well, obviously these areas where I'm not conforming or I'm not wanting, or there's something that's not designed to support it. So the easy thing to do is to go focus on those things that you are doing.
Which is, you know, what a lot of Christianity preaches. Focus on your strengths and downplay your weaknesses.
Right.
I'm sorry, that ain't
fine. But my problem was I wasn't downplaying my weaknesses, I was putting them aside and saying, okay, well, there's going to come time to put your statements and so forth. And then, you know, we're really dealt with the mentality of that. And the focus that I've got now with what showed me was that even though I do things, it doesn't mean that I don't want to do it or I'm not looking for it. So I need to do things. Because it's easy to think when you do something, well, it's not really want to work in that area. And I had to think to myself, well, that's not right because what's in me is not myself.
Right.
And what's in me wants to. You know, Christ was the Lord of the Father. So what am I saying? Kind of like, you know, I'm counter-confessing what's true. So I had to sit there and go, okay, no, that's not true, even though I may do it. And I'm starting to understand more of the stuff I'm doing is not intentional stuff. I used to dream about things intentional. It's all reactionary. And I'm learning to get through the reactionary stuff. But anytime I do it now, instead of going, well, it's not like the Lord, I just say, okay, I messed up, but I do want to do it. That's what the truth is.
Yes.
I do want to, not the opposite direction. So therefore, I will not
let
it manifest itself.
You're saying you're identifying yourself as the right person,
right.
The spirit.
Right.
You do that.
Yes.
That's good. I'm going to cut you off, but I want to make sure that. Okay. That's good. Okay, so now obviously there is, during this struggle, there needs to be a breakthrough. Amen. There needs to be some kind of a breakthrough because the Christian life is not this struggle, this constant. That's not the Christian life. That's not what God has called us to. That's the wilderness of God moving and being and some glorious things going on to God, you know, upset, bad things going on. I mean, that's the wilderness. That's not entering into this thing yet, okay? And so there has to be something that actually begins to bring the spirit to the forefront. And the Holy, and you're not going to be aware of your spirit coming to the forefront. You're really going to be aware of the Lord coming to the forefront. But your spirit is actually starting to operate more. Okay? And then at the same time, a decrease, how about that? Does that sound good? A decrease in the sense realm. We're talking about life and life. And there's actually one that precedes life. What is it? That precedes it. And that is in Him. In Him, in the beginning was the Word. In Him was life, and the life is the light of men. You see? In Him, this is what Scripture says. In Him who? It's only described the Word. And He's called the same. So really, it's only given one title for Him, really, in that sense, the Word, who is the same, but it is the Word. And in Him was life. And the life is the life. Progression. Now that's better. That, you know, it's good to see progression. You know why? Because a lot of times if you pick up the wrong piece and you start handling life, but you're studying life when you need to study the complete thought concept of God, then what you're going to do is you're going to spend a lot of time studying, but you can't make progress because you've taken it out of order. All right. But what we said is the life was always there because it's the same, isn't it? It's in Him, and He is the same. So that always has been, was, and is, and it's come. Alpha and Omega, remember we discussed all this. Beginning and end, total thought, this is it. Everything else that comes out of this is just going to be made stuff. But it's the made stuff which we are made. It means to find out about this. That's what life is. Everybody with me? Okay, so that's what it's all about. So, but for us to, even though this is first and second, this is third, for us to enter into it, we have to come by way of light. Don't we? Because this always was. How are we going to know that? Light. Are you with me? Okay, so here's Saul of Tarsus, later to be known as the Apostle Paul, right? But before he met the Lord, he was Saul of Tarsus. And what is Saul doing? He is Saul the Pharisee. He is a Pharisee. He knows the light of the law. He said, as touching the law, he was blameless. He did really good. He was a hard worker. He was measured up. He outdistanced all of his brethren, is the literal Greek there in Galatians when he said that I forget the exact word, but he did better than all of his, you know, those that were equal in the faith. And here he is persecuting the truth, but he doesn't know it, because how can you persecute the truth until you know the truth? You know what I mean? I mean, in that sense, I mean, you're just persecuted blindly. You're not persecuting the truth. You're persecuting something, but you're not persecuting. But it's when you know the truth and you go against it that you're called a really bad person. That's what the devil is. So here he goes. He's heading out to kill some more Christians and stuff like that. He's on the road to Damascus. And what happens? He has an encounter not just with the Lord who walked just a short time before this and killed him. You know, that's what we usually see. We see Jesus of Nazareth kind of appear in a little light-enveloping thing, kind of hovering right above his head, and going, "I am the Lord." And he goes, "Wow." But that's not really what happened. He saw this, or began to see this. He didn't see this, but he began. And what happened, what simultaneously happened as he encountered the real living Lord, not one he'd heard about, Messiah, that he believed in, but never really met any kind of a real way. What happened simultaneously with the spiritual awakening to them? Light. Light shined, and when it shined, he became blind. Did you know that light blinds and destroys? But not in this realm, not in the spirit, for it opens your eyes here. It shows you what is here, but it blinds you down here. Okay, so here he is. He's seeing, he's feeling, he's tasting, he's touching. Boom! He meets the Lord. Now he can't see nothing, can't feel, you know, can't make his way around. He don't know what's going on in the sense realm. God blocked him all in the sense realm so that he could start his man out right. Don't be looking and figuring it out from this. Trust me, I'm going to send somebody away. They're going to pray for you. You're going to get healed, but you're going to get the Holy Spirit. And Paul saw the value of that and ended up going out 3 years into the desert where he wouldn't be cold and all this. Where he could get down to business, of, as it were, for a while, in a certain sense, depriving his senses. And you have senses if you're in a hole in the ground that you put there for 6 months. Your senses are still operating. But I found it valuable, and I think Paul did, and I think God used this pattern over and over again to deprive your senses. There's another term for it. It's called fasting. We all think of fasting in terms of food. I don't. I think of fasting a lot. I fast a lot. But it's not necessarily food, although I guess that's a lot of lunches. But there are times I'll be driving down the road and I'll step up and say, feed me, feed me. And I say, you're not in charge here. I'll do what I want to. I'll listen to the tapes of the Lord and do something else, but I don't jump just because you say jump. You're not my God. Because God is their God. In the scripture, because God is their God. The scripture says, you're not my God. You are my servant. Jesus is my God. I am his servant, and you are my servant. Give it to me of God to serve me, not me to serve you. Guys, I wish I'd do it all the time, but I can't think of all the examples. There are many times when I actively know, no, I'm going to fast you. You are not going to get your way. Some feeling, some this, some that. And I do that regularly enough to let my senses know that you don't rule me. You don't rule me. Now, as most of us know, fasting, there's no magic to fasting. Fasting really doesn't work unless you're spiritually... most of us fast and get some. And I don't really see that a whole lot in scriptures. And a lot of us will fast to get spiritual. But in reality, I think because you're spiritual, you'll fast. Because that's not funny. I don't mean food either, once again. Because you are spiritual, you would take control over this or over that or say no to this. The last thing you need to do is not be spiritual fast because you'll find out who your God is. Do you understand what I'm saying? You'll find out who's in charge. And then you'll really be discouraged because you're trying to get with the Lord and your senses run away with you.
I was reading in Jeremiah 4:3 says, break up the fallow ground and sow not among the thorns. Well, in Matthew chapter 13, the thorns were the cares and the deceitfulness of this world, or the sensual realm. So in other words, telling us not to be sowing amongst all of this. This is, you're not going to be able to get anything if you're sowing amongst the sensual realm.
I think it was Brian, he was sitting there last night, we were in the skating field, and I brought my guitar. He said, wow, you must play all the time. And I just laughed and said, I hardly ever play, but the chances I get to play is when we're all together and I can bring it and talk and play and whatever. But when I'm not around, you don't see me with this, I'm usually not with it that much. And so I said, that's just the way it is, but it looks to you like I must play all the time, and I play very little. But that reminded me of the subject of when I'm at home, say Monday, my day with the Lord. Well, my day with the Lord includes practical work, stuff I have to have prepared. I mean, I have to, there's stuff I worked on for John class coming up, I have to do that. I do yard work. I do all kind of stuff. But one of the things, if I get a little chance, is I like to, if I get the chance, I like to pull out my guitar. I relax while I can play my guitar. And so if I get the chance, I'll pull it out. But when I wake up in the morning, especially if I haven't had any time in a week or 2 weeks to even touch the guitar, and here I'm trying to learn, and how are you ever going to learn if you don't ever get a chance to touch it, you know what I mean? And so the first thing I get up, like a little kid, I've got a full day here, and my mama went on to be the Lord. So Randy has to talk to Randy. And Randy's spirit has to talk to Randy's soul. And Randy's spirit says, no, we're not going to start with that. We're going to start with, and usually I start with the Lord, okay? In the beginning is the Word, okay? So I start with the Lord. And I study and I do whatever I need to do to get going in that. And if you're like me, after 2 or 3, 4 hours, you're starting to get bogged down. So usually, then you're, let's do this, that. No, man, you got some weeds out there and stuff. Better than go out there and pull some weeds. So get up, I'll go out there because that's for my family or whatever I do. That's for my family. So I go out there and it's good exercise and I need some exercise too. So I go out there and I do that. And then finally, if he's been a good boy, I let him play the guitar. That's fasting, if you understand what I mean. It's not letting me do what I want to do when I want to do it. And there's some real wisdom behind that. And you want to know what an immature person is? It's a person who wants to do what they want to do when they want to do it. That's immaturity. One way that you can tell somebody's growing up is when they say, say no, and they say, okay. I see that in my kids. I see that in Nisi. And Nisi really was one that, had some tendencies to want to have her way, and I see her changing. And I think some of it just comes with maturity and time. But maybe it does and maybe it doesn't. Maybe there has to be a time where we say to ourselves, no, we ain't gonna do that. We're gonna, there's times you say, okay, but here's my, and I've had an opportunity to watch hardly any TV in so long, I forgot what it is other than a videotape of some guitar riffs. Maybe there's some TV thing, and you go, man, I really haven't been with the Lord. Oh, but this, if I miss this episode, then it's kind of like a soap opera. I won't know where we're at. So you say yes to your soul. Sometimes you have to fast. I would do it even if it's not absolutely necessary. I would every once in a while just fast something. Do you know what I'm talking about? Something. Just learn to say no to your body or your what you want. Just learn to say no. And if you can successfully do that a little bit all along, you'll grow. Because if you can't do that little practical thing, what if the Lord really wants you? You always say yes to yourself. Well, you don't say yes to yourself or your body. You're going to. There's just no question about it. So get in the habit of, from time to time, saying no. Some of the times you might find out how really hard that is, and it might show you that you really, really need the Lord bad. When you thought you didn't really, really need the Lord, it can be a real eye-opener. Because, something rises up and goes, what do you mean, no? And then you go, I'm just kidding, let's go. some of you know what I'm talking about. And you say, wait a minute, I'm in charge here. You're in charge, I want my whatever right now. Well, if you can't handle that one, pick on something little for a while and learn and grow. Yeah. David killed the lion, then the bear, the bear, then the lion, then went for Goliath. He didn't just go out and tackle the lion. You know what I'm saying? So you want to make some ground, pick on something small first, but work up. Don't just stick with a few little things and say, whoa, what a good boy am I. Okay, so, in conclusion, he saw the light. The light awakened him to the realm he didn't know about. He didn't know anything about the Lord. He didn't know. He was enlightened, but he was blind at the same time. He began to be blind to these things, and this began to grow. His spirit began to grow, but you don't even realize that. I didn't know that until years later. I just knew the Lord was becoming, I was seeing him more and growing in, you know what I mean? And then I realized, well, I do that through my spirit. Oh, well, the theology thing is, just works. And then you look back and see, oh, I'm growing spiritually by, you know, you can grow in information and not grow spiritually. Because only if your spirit is growing are you growing spiritually. We feed our souls a lot of information about the Lord and stuff. We feed our bodies a lot of ministries. And we say we're growing spiritually, and maybe we haven't grown spiritually in months or years. You know what I'm saying? I know what I'm saying. And I guess that's all that's really important. Alright, so in conclusion, in him, in the Word, we draw it like this, as if it is truly. Not the scriptures or the letter, but we go here and get the Word. In him, we see Christ. We see the total thought concept of God. And when we see that, we see that it is life. It's not just theology or fact. It is life. And that life is light to us. Because we begin to be enlightened to this life, not to stuff. I don't know how else to put it. It is a person that we see. He is the light of life. And he becomes the light of the world. It shines in darkness. And they go, but to us, he's not the light of the world. He is the light of life. Big difference. Just depends on which end of the sword you're on. So you have to be a friend or dad. Just depends on what end of the gender you're on. Well, the light can be a friend or an enemy. If he's the light of the world, he's an enemy. Because they've been during the world. But if he's light of life, it means pretty good. Right? Did you turn anything out of this? I don't know, really, a lot of things kind of looks there. Praise God, we really moved through these notes. I read one sentence. True light blinds and destroys. That's all I read. And we read so good. But we will finish this verse before this class is over. For this course. And Father, we just thank you for your grace. Thank you, Lord, that you are leading us, guiding, teaching, bringing us. But Lord, it is not the teaching, for that tends to be remembering when we were taught, not what. It's not the leading, for that tends to be linear, as you lead instead of being aware of where you are leading. Father, remove us from the dealings. Not be removed from being dealt with, but remove us from the dealings as if the dealings are spiritual, or if the dealings are what it's all about. For they are simply happening in our lives to bring us into the greater reality. Father, we feed our sense realms by the dealing. It comforts us. It comforts our soul. And instead of fearing now, we were dealt with. So, Father, then we feel at peace instead of having a Prince of Peace, instead of Jesus being our peace. And the proof of that is, Lord, we get down the road and we begin to fear because we haven't had a dealing in our life. Father, I just pray you wean us from the dealing and bring us into what you are dealing with us. In Jesus' name.